Hello, everybody. So I've been streaming a lot lately, twitch.tv/woolygaming, by the way. And the most common question I get from the chat is something along the lines of, how do I get better on Monsoon? Or how do I know when to stop farming and go for the boss? Or what is a good time to have when looping the game? All of those questions can be simplified to, how do I get better, essentially? So in this video, I will give concise tips and advice on what I've found improves my runs the most. The advice I'll give is catered towards Monsoon difficulty, as it is what I play on exclusively. Before we begin, a quick disclaimer. There is a ton of context that goes into how each stage plays out. In fact, so much that if I were going into all the details on every single thing that happens in one of my runs, we'd be here for over an hour easily. Therefore, this info should be used to supplement your playstyle and not be taken as the only possible way of playing the game. You know a lot more about how you play the game than I do, and these tips take that into account. All right, let's get into it. The first and probably most important tip I can give is stop full clearing stages on your first loop. This one is a bit controversial, to say the least, so let me explain. Time is extremely valuable in this game. Not kind of valuable, not just valuable, but very valuable. It's so valuable that literally every system that determines how the game plays out is calculated with time as one of its variables. The other variable that always is involved in the difficulty of your run is the number of stages you have completed. So the most efficient way to optimize your runs is finding the balance, finding that sweet spot of doing the best amount of stages in the best amount of time. Here's a quick rundown. I won't go into tons of detail, but I will leave the links to what I'm showing in my pinned comment below, so check that out. All right, so I'm here on the Risk of Rain 2 wiki, and I want to show you guys just how important not only time is to how your run progresses, but also the number of stages you complete. It's all about finding a nice balance between time and the number of stages you complete. So I'll leave the links in the comment below. I'm not going to go over everything in detail, so if you want to do the reading to get all the specific details, go ahead, look at my comment below, and there'll be the links to the wiki. But what I want to cover is scaling difficulty and the math of the scaling difficulty. So scaling difficulty, we've all seen the bar here, right? You guys look up and you can see this little bar, and then there's the notches. There's two notches, they call them intermediate notches per difficulty. Okay, and all you got to know is as the game goes on and the more stages you complete, that bar will fill up faster. And when you get to the ha 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 difficulty here, that bar will still go up, despite it only saying ha ha ha, but it still goes up. So you are always, always, always getting increased difficulty. So not only does it increase over time, but every stage that you complete, the difficulty jumps forward. And you probably notice that when you activate the teleporter and you go to a new stage, the bar will boop, jump up a little bit. And I believe it's 15% of the current value. And I know it's 15%. I just can't find where it is. Like I said, I'm not going to show you the specific details, but you can definitely go and find these values. So the other big thing I want to talk about is time. Time goes hand in hand with the number of stages you complete. So right here, this coefficient is calculating everything to do with difficulty in the game. And that's not an exaggeration. So we'll go down here. Effects on enemy level, boom, there's the coefficient. Money cost, there's the coefficient. Enemy XP reward coefficient, enemy gold reward coefficient, and the directors have the enemy spawn in the game. Again, I'll link to this in the comment below, and you can go check that, and the coefficient has to do with absolutely everything on the director as well. So the coefficient is the most important formula in the game, and that is determined by a player factor, which is always going to be one if you're playing with one player, so don't worry about it if you're playing single player. Just essentially, the more players you have, the harder the game is, obviously. Then time in minutes, so the longer the game goes on, that also goes into the coefficient, multiplied by the time factor. And the time factor is just the difficulty value, essentially, of the game. So a flat number multiplied by difficulty value multiplied by player count, which, like I said, is always going to be one if it's only you. So difficulty value is just a single number. It's going to be one if you're on Drizzle, two if you're on Rainstorm, three if you're on Monsoon. That's all it is. And that's easy, normal, and hard difficulty, respectively. And then finally, stage factor right here is exponentially increased based on the number of stages you've completed, which is an extremely important detail to go over. But all of that said, time and number of stages you complete are the most important things to how your run progresses, okay? So let's keep that in mind as we go back into the video here.
So, as you saw from that clip, time and stage completion go hand in hand. In my over 130 hours played so far, most of which being on Monsoon, I found that my runs are most consistent when I focus on the same set of goals in the early game. I'll say it again, stop farming every item in the earlier stages. The reason is because the power of your character is largely determined by the point where the randomness rolls something beneficial for you. As in, it's all random. When the randomness is in your favor, you get stronger. When it's not only do you not become stronger, you get straight up weaker because the difficulty is always increasing. Now, you may be saying, if it's all random, then shouldn't I be looking for the most chances at getting items? The more items I get, the more chances I have of them being good, yeah? Well, absolutely. This is exactly what I'm proposing, but with one key difference, time. Simply going for all the items in a stage, especially early on, completely neglects the time factor. This game will not wait up for you. If you fall behind, it is extremely hard to turn the run around. Therefore, keeping a faster pace, meaning skipping over chests that are too far away, is important than waiting around for another 2 to 3 minutes while the monsters slowly trickle in. The spawn rate of monsters, and by extension, the rate at which you gain money, is very slow early on. You should all know that from playing the game. Farming anything more than 2 or 3 chests on the first stage will easily add 1 to 2 extra minutes. Therefore, as per the clip I just showed, moving on to the next stage and bumping the difficulty up will increase the rate at which monsters spawn and thus enable you to farm for more items quicker. Obviously, there are a few exceptions to this rule. The best way for me to put it is that if you can consistently get the guaranteed Preon accumulator from the Rally Point Delta, which is stage 3, the snow map, and that's acquired by finding the box before the 10-minute mark, then you are at a very good pace. If you average 4 to 4.5 minutes per stage before looping the game, obviously, you are at a very good spot for the run. Here's an easy-to-follow list of my top priorities when starting a new stage on the first loop. Number 1, look for combat shrines. Combat shrines are insane to get early on, but are absolutely nuts on the first stage. When activated, they spawn a group of monsters instantly, often containing an elite monster, and elites give more money on kill than normals. So immediately finding and going for combat shrines will boost your income drastically and by extension give you more chances at potentially good items. Number 2 would be to find the teleporter. As the goal is to progress to the next stage as soon as possible, the teleporter is key to find early on. The chest and multi-shop terminals you buy need to be close to the teleporter. Again, there are exceptions, such as finding a multi-shop terminal near your spawn, which is generally pretty far from the teleporter, that contains an essential item, like a syringe or a sticky bomb or a backup mag, etc., etc. In cases such as that, where you're farming for guaranteed to be useful loot that is far from the teleporter, you should stick around that item's area, wait for enough money to grab the item, and then make your way to the teleporter. Finally, number 3, scout the area around the teleporter for 2 to 3 chests or multi-shops. Again, your goal is to get to the next stage as soon as possible, so wasting your time running all around the map looking for items is a bad idea. You should look in a semicircle-shaped area around the teleporter for the closest chests, both regular and large, and multi-shop terminals. And if large chests contain a guaranteed green or red item, they won't have any white items. If it takes more than 10 seconds to run to, you should probably just skip it and move on to the next stage, because the money you have in your inventory when you teleport will be turned into XP and still boost your character's power, even though you didn't spend it on an item. To recap, your top priority is to find a combat shrine, then look for the teleporter, and finally look for the closest loot to the teleporter. You should spawn the boss once you have 1, maybe 2 items that help with the kill, or if you're level 3, whichever comes first. After you kill the boss and charge the teleporter, go back to the loot items that are closest, get them, and leave the stage. If you're doing all of this in around 4.5 minutes, you're in a very good spot. Again, this is all situational. There have been times where I just spawn the boss at level 1 and go to the next stage immediately because there's nothing really close to the teleporter and it would take way too much time and RNG would have to be on my side in order for me to get good items. Speaking of farming items, let's talk about the guaranteed legendary chest on stage 4, the Abyssal Depths. More often than not, I will farm for this chest. However, I'd say also more often than not, the item I get really doesn't boost my overall power too much. I'm still experimenting with farming for the chest and not, but as of now, I'd say if you are at a point where killing monsters takes quite a bit of time, if you're slacking on AoE capability and single target damage especially, then it is much better to farm for everything but the legendary chest. If you didn't know, large chests, again, they contain a guaranteed green or red item, are twice the price of a normal chest. Legendary chests are more than 8 times the cost of a large chest, meaning they are over 16 times the price of a normal chest. 16 times. Do you really want to save all your money when you aren't even killing stuff that fast to begin with, only to open a chest and get a frost relic or a mask? No, you'd be much better off opening the regular chest and especially the green multi-shop terminals on the map to get items that will power you up and many times greater than that of the RNG of the legendary chest. So, if you're in dire need of damage, farm for the large chest and multi-shop terminals. By the way, every single multi-shop terminal on stage 4 will contain green items to choose from and not white items. But if you're blowing through monsters with that big old sticky bomb perna you found on stage 3, then by all means go for the legendary chest. Finally, the last thing I'd like to cover is the power of the blue portal. If you guys don't have lunar coins, go and get some right now. Play on easy, literally rush the teleporter on every stage until you get the celestial orb on your second time on the snow map, and obliterate yourself for 5 lunar coins. Why? Because the bazaar between time, which is the blue portal, is so powerful. It is jam-packed with potential run-breaking stuff. Risk of Rain 2 is all about risk versus reward. If you know when to take the risks for the greatest potential rewards, your runs will end up being much more consistent. The blue portal is where the reward is way higher than the risk, like insanely higher. The ability to get a guaranteed green, but more importantly red item by trading in your white or green items respectively is very powerful. Not to mention, you get 4 chances at lunar items, shaped glass, Transcendence, and Gesture of the Drowned being what you're looking for. Each one of those specific lunar items has the potential to entirely change your run for the better. So I'd always recommend saving some lunar coins for when the blue orb randomly spawns on your stage, or if you want to get a guaranteed portal by finding a newt altar on the map. Either way, the blue portal is definitely worth taking. Even if you have 0 coins to spend on lunar items, trading your useless whites and greens for run-baking greens and reds is definitely worth it. Alright, and that pretty much covers everything I wanted to say with easy-to-follow tips and advice for the early game. If you have any questions or want to discuss some stuff further, leave your comment below and I will definitely definitely read it and probably respond too. All the clips you saw were taken from my live stream at twitch.tv/woolygaming. It's all one word. So if you enjoyed the footage, consider following me there. Also, we're about to hit 100 subscribers on Twitch. So Twitch Prime, by the way. Thank you for watching.